Meanwhile, Philippine Ambassador to the United States Jose Manuel Romualdez urges the public to move on and to stop the blame game over the Pfizer vaccine mess. The ambassador says the Philippines is still in talks with three other American firms for possible deals. Ambassador Romualdez now joins us this morning for the latest in the vaccine negotiations. Good morning, sir. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Olivia.
Ambassador, what's the status of the negotiations with the two vaccine developers in the U.S. that are ready to supply the Philippines with up to 25 million doses of vaccines against coronavirus next year? Those are Moderna and Arcturus. In what stage of the negotiations are we in?
Yes, as a matter of fact, they are already in discussions with Secretary Galvez. And from what I understand, that they will probably be able to close that within the next couple of days. So that's very good news. And like I said, there are many other vaccine makers or developers here in the United States and other parts of the world. But here in the United States, there are about three or four that are about to be approved for emergency use and eventually be used for the general public. So I think we're in a good place, even if there's a delay in some of these vaccines that that could be delivered to the Philippines, we will be at that point where we will have enough vaccines by the middle of next year.
Mm-hmm. If the deals with the two firms, U.S. firms, materialize in the next couple of days, as you said, how soon can they deliver, and how many, from 4 to 25 million doses, can they deliver in the country?
I think it would be safe to say that all of that we can be delivered by the second quarter of next year. However, like I said, because there are many countries who obviously want these vaccines, the sooner we sign up, the better, so that they can schedule it. No? And I think we could safely say that we could possibly ask for vaccines, maybe not the amount that we are ordering, but a certain percentage of that amount can be delivered a little earlier than the delivered date of second half of next year. Which is very possible, considering that most of these developers are now ramping up production, already anticipating that they will get the full approval from the FDA.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned that we're at the final stages of the negotiations. Can you give us the details of the respective proposals of these two firms, Moderna and Arcturus, to the Philippine government?
Well, the only thing I can say is that Moderna, as we've been talking to them at the same time as we were talking to Pfizer. So they're already at that stage where they've signed all the agreements that needed to be signed, meaning the CDAs and all of that. So it's just a matter of us now deciding on how much of that or how many of that vaccines we will be requiring or ordering from them. No?
Mm-hmm.
And mind you, there, Pfizer is still in the picture. I know that we're still discussing with Pfizer on how we can get the vaccines when the next batch of or the next batch of their vaccines are going to be produced, which is again second half of next year.
Right. And how much are these firms, specifically for Moderna and for Arcturus, offering their vaccines to us? As we know, Moderna, from the reports, it's at around 3,900 to 4,500 pesos per dose. Is that the amount
again,
that's stated in the agreement?
I am not privy to that one, but I can tell you, Vivian, that this prices are really dependent on how many. It's a volume. It's like any kind of arrangement. You have to, the price is based on the volume that we will get. Of course, the more we get, the cheaper it will be. But
mm-hmm.
I think it's something that we really should not be concerned about, because since we all know that this is one particular product that we need, and I think the president has already clearly stated we're prepared to pay whatever we need to pay to be able to get those vaccines as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Aside from that, we also have a lot of potential financiers, which is really the Asia Development Bank and the World Bank. And the WHO is also working closely with all the countries, developing countries like the Philippines, that are prepared to help in financing the purchases. So I don't think that's going to be really a problem. It's more on the delivery of these vaccines and how quickly we can get them.
Mm-hmm.
And I also would like to point out that the Philippines is actually going to be in the center of most of these vaccines coming from the West, especially from the United States. As you know, Federal Express is a big hub in Clark, and they are the transport of choice of many of these vaccine companies that will be transporting these vaccines. So we will most likely be the hub of the of these vaccines. It will be delivered through FedEx and mm-hmm. their hub in Clark, and then distributed to the Asian countries. So it's a very it's a natural for us to be able to have access to these vaccines.
Now we know, Ambassador, that Moderna's vaccine against COVID has a 94.1% efficacy, can be stored in normal freezers, and would need two doses to work. What about for Arcturus's vaccine? What do we know about it so far?
Well, this one is also a new technology, it's almost similar to Moderna and Pfizer, except that you only need one. But that one is still on phase two, I think, and it will still take some time. So we're really talking more of the third quarter for Arcturus. No? Mm-hmm. So, but right now, I think we are talking to three of the major ones, AstraZeneca, as you pointed out, Pfizer and Moderna.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we also are talking to Novavax, which is also another American pharmaceutical company that has developed a vaccine that is expected to have the approval of the FDA here.
Right.
So there's a whole and next year, by the way, there are about 18 of these vaccine companies or these vaccine developers that would probably get their approvals not only here from the United States but from Europe and from other parts of the world as well.
Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, we are still in the running for the Pfizer vaccine. But how many doses of COVID vaccines has Pfizer allocated for the Philippines?
That again is something that the number that was mentioned in all this controversy. And by the way, as I said, it's really time to move on. And you know, I'd like to, in hindsight, I'd like to probably take part of the blame because I should have called Secretary Galvez and Secretary Duque directly instead of passing through the usual channels really tell them how urgent it was that we needed that CDA. But that's all past now. And so I think we're in a good place. We have Secretary Galvez who's in charge of the procurement of these vaccines. And right now, it's in his hands on how many we need from all of these various companies that are going to be supplying us. So it's really up to him. But he did say that we have more than enough to be able to cover for at least 60 million, to cover 60 million of our people, which is really the number that we really need so that we will have the herd immunity.
Ambassador, I know you just mentioned that we need to move on and stop the blame game. But just so we get a clarification, speaking of the supposed missed opportunity to have a vaccine in the country from as early as next month, because according to DFA Secretary Loxin, somebody dropped the ball. Vaccine Czar Secretary Galvez said there was neither a bus missed or a ball dropped in the negotiations. And Health Secretary Duque also said that he did not recall getting a guarantee from Pfizer on 10 million vaccines.
Well, I guess to clarify that, I don't think there's anyone really to be blamed. Like I said, we have a government process in procurement, and I know that all of these are government procedures that you need to be able to but we are in an emergency situation, so I think what the president has done is to cut many of his red tapes, and I think, like I said, no one has expected anything like this. So we're just really moving to a certain level now that we are prepared to now sign up if we need to as quickly as possible. But like I said, the urgency at that time was because Secretary Loxin spoke to Secretary Pompeo to as early as July. And even before that, we were already given instructions by the president to see how quickly we can get hold of some of the vaccines that were being developed here in the United States. And now that number of 10 million is something that we mentioned to Pfizer because they needed a number to be able to sort of like reserve for us. Mm-hmm. Whether it's going to be delivered or not is something that we will only have known if we had signed the contract for us to purchase it now. But definitely we would have been part of the first batch of what they had developed or what has been approved, which is about, from what I'm told, is about 200 million or more than that doses that they were already producing, even if without the FDA approval yet. Mm-hmm. So, but again, it's really not something that we should really be concerned about, because while the delay is a couple of months, we have to understand that we also want to make sure that number one, we have the funds for it, which we do now, and secondly, we also would like to be able to see the other vaccines, and that's why the first vaccine that we actually signed up for, which was privately funded by the private sector, was the AstraZeneca, but that had a problem, and so that's why that's been delayed through no fault of ours, but because there was some effect or some side effects of the of AstraZeneca, and so they're now doing another test to be able to see the efficacy of that particular vaccine.
Mm-hmm. But just to guide us moving forward, how do you think should we balance the urgency of procuring vaccines against COVID and the caution against possibly onerous provisions in the agreements with these pharmaceutical companies?
Well, again, I understand exactly where Secretary Duque is coming from. You know, as a government official, he wants to make sure that these contracts are free and clear of any liability for the government. And so it's very important that we have that. But again, because of the urgency of the situation, sometimes you take your chances. I really wouldn't know what to do if I were in his place, but most likely if I see it that it's something that it's worth taking a chance for, because lives are being lost because of the pandemic, I probably would have taken the initiative. I don't know, but I guess that's all in hindsight now. But the most important thing is that we are moving, and I think that we're moving in the right direction with both Secretary Galvez and the other members of the IATF that are moving very quickly, and also with the Secretary Dominguez making sure that we have the funds to cover it. We have the Asian Development Bank and the World Bank ready to give us a lending hand, and these are cheap money that is being made available for us, not only because we have a good credit rating, but because these are very difficult times for many countries like ours. And so we have all of these facilities ready for us now, and I think the public can sleep well that not too long from now, these vaccines will be within our shores, and we'll be getting all of us will be, I guess, hopefully be ready to go back to normal again.
Ambassador, you also recommend a COVID-19 home test kit developed by digital diagnostics company Elume, which delivers rapid and accurate results in 15 minutes or less. Can you tell us more about it? How does this compare to the PCR test, which is supposedly the golden standard in testing for COVID-19?
But this one has just been approved by the FDA here in the United States. We saw a demonstration recently, and I think that this is very effective. And this is something that right now I think it's going to be sold here in the United States for about $30, which is approximately 1,200 or 1,300 pesos for us. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that if we do decide to purchase this, we can get again discounted bulk price, and it can be sold in our drugstores, and everyone can, it's so easy to do it. I understand it's just a matter of swabbing, and then they put it in 15 to 20 minutes, you get the results, and it's about 90% to 95% accurate. So that will definitely help us, and that's very important. We just remember that the vaccine doesn't mean that it's over. Mm-hmm. It only means that we are now in the process of getting everybody immune, but it'll take time, you know? So it's important that the testing now will be able to help each home, because you can bring this at home and you can do it yourself, will be able to test themselves. And if they're obviously, if they're infected, they should follow the 14-day quarantine or be ready to go to the hospital. Mm-hmm. That will greatly help a lot of our people and the population in controlling the pandemic.
Right. So this home test kit is definitely cheaper than a PCR test, less than half of the price, and around 90% efficacy. But how can we procure this? How many can we procure, and how soon can this be delivered if we procure it?
Well, from what I understand, again, this will be available for international distribution by early next year, which is January or February next year. So almost at the same time that all these vaccines are going to be rolled out, you will be getting, it will be available for in the market. So we should be ready to have this, be ready to purchase it. In fact, I just talked to Secretary Galvez, mm-hmm. and I will send him the details of this one so that he can his group can study it and see how this could be used by our people there, or be in fact the government maybe it might even be useful for the government to be the one to implement this this testing kits so that especially in communities where you don't really have people that can afford to buy something like this, they can be the one to administer it, to be very quick and very accurate. So again, I recommend that we get this or something similar to it if there's one in the market.
Thank you so much for your time, Philippine Ambassador to the United States, Jose Manuel Romualdez.
Thank you very much, too, for inviting me.